Welcome to what is the last video of the course, Critical Thinking. And today we are just going to try to wrap it all up and hopefully everything fits together and the whole thing becomes clear. And if it doesn't, well, we tried. Remember that what we're trying to do is to be able to tell the difference between someone who we think is totally making up, like this psychic Nikki, who is predicting in 2020, nearly over. So I see a lot of penguins and polar bears leaving the Arctic and dying and coming down for food. Somehow that didn't make the news. Nikki didn't predict pandemics, so seems like an omission. Our flag carrier, our model of the good scientist, Dr. Fauci here, he's predicting next January to be a really dark time for the U.S. unless substantial mitigation is carried out. Well, we shall see, and I guess, you know, our goal is, we got two people making two predictions. Why would we think, well, this one prediction is something to be taken very seriously, and this other one, well, actually, you know, we'd probably want to take that seriously too, but probably not because she says so. So what's up with that? We are trying to explain how scientists come to their conclusions, how they adopt one theory rather than another. One of the people who first kind of put their finger on this was actually Darwin, who in his Origin of the Species and started to explain this very big theory he's got, kind of explaining everything biological. Proposes what he calls inference to the best explanation. It seems to me that supposing that such a hypothesis were to explain such general propositions, we ought, in accordance with the common way of following all sciences, to admit it until some better hypothesis be found out. Notice he's not saying it's true absolutely forever. He's just saying, well, this is the best we got, so let's run with it. Maybe in fewer and simpler words, and this is coming from a philosopher named Gilbert Harman, inference to the best explanation is when one infers from the premise that a hypothesis provides a better explanation for the evidence than any other hypothesis to the conclusion the hypothesis is true. And if we were to structure that in the way we have done arguments in this course, we'll have the premise explanation E is the best explanation of or for X, therefore E is true. And when you formulated it like that, you see that, well, that doesn't seem like all that great an argument, right? You might even be worried that there's a little bit of fallacy of relevance going on here, that something, because something's the best explanation, isn't strictly speaking relevant to whether or not it's true. And so, you know, we should be nervous about that. And then we remind ourselves, oh yeah, this is inductive logic. Nothing's guaranteed. Nothing is for sure. So this fits into our general understanding of what we're trying to do here. We're trying to come up with ways of thinking about these problems that are better than any alternative, but are not guaranteed. And so then we say, okay, great. We're gonna infer to the best explanation. Now we just need to agree what best explanation is. When we have that best explanation, what does that mean? And there's a trivial way of thinking about this that is just frustrating, because of course you'd say, well, the best explanation would be whichever one is true. And in a way that's obviously correct, right? If you did have sort of inside knowledge in what's true, that would be the best explanation. But given that we don't have any inside, there isn't a big book hidden away somewhere we can look all this stuff in. We don't know what we're trying to find out through science. That's the point of it. And so to say it's best if it's true really is just circular reasoning. It's just as unhelpful as anything else that's begging the question, right? Because if it's true, then it's the best explanation. And therefore, if it's the best explanation, therefore it's true. It doesn't work for anyone. And so we would need to define best in some other way than besides defining it in terms of truth. So we'll have these criteria for theories. And we've got internal consistency being kind of an underrated criteria here. Your textbook doesn't spend a lot of time on this, but what we mean here is this is free of internal contradictions. One part of an explanation didn't work against another part, or it doesn't contradict any evidence. So if your theory predicts that when you look through your telescope, you'll see a planet exactly there, and it's not there, that is a failure of consistency. And, when you don't have that consistency, then you can decide, am I going to revise my theory, add further ad hoc hypotheses, or am I going to reject it outright? We know that any theory can be saved with enough tinkering. And so once we get the internal consistencies worked out, then our criteria of adequacy, and this is where your textbook spends most of its effort describing these things. And this is all starting on page 374, if you're keeping track at home. And this closely follows the work of Thomas Kuhn, who's a philosopher of science, most of his writing in the 70s, 1970s. And so we've got these criteria here, testability, simplicity, fruitfulness, scope, and conservatism. And we'll say something about each of these in turn. Remember, internal consistency, lack of contradiction. And we define contradiction a couple different ways within the course, right? So we thought about contradiction in syllogistic logic being that diagonal across the square of opposition. So if a claim is, universal and positive, then the contradiction would be a negative and particular. And so we define that as any two statements that cannot both be true and cannot both be false at the same time. So if you had two statements that were locked into each other such that they couldn't both be true and couldn't be both at the same time, in your theory is not internally consistent. We could also think of contradiction as being, in propositional logic, a statement that is false under all possible circumstances. So typically, to find a contradiction in your theory, you would have a conjunction of two different statements, right? So you say, my theory is true because my theory predicts there'll be a planet in exactly that point in the sky, and my evidence includes no planet in the sky. So then you'd have those two things. You conjunct them together with an and statement, then you'd have false, 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 false all the way down. That's what we mean by internally inconsistent, meaning it has a contradiction somewhere. So examples of internal inconsistency, right? And we saw one just even a lecture ago when we saw how Karl Popper's falsifiability theory was like everything should be falsifiable. And someone at some point said, okay, Mr. Popper, is that falsifiable? And if he's saying everything is falsifiable and there's one theory, mainly his own, that's not, that's an internal inconsistency. We often think of inconsistencies in something, especially like our favorite police procedural shows, where someone has an alibi, right? So you're predicting, if your theory is they're guilty because they were, you know, in the attic with the murder weapon at the time the deed was done, and there's evidence that they were across this, the other side of the town in a different place at the same time, those are inconsistent because someone can't be in two different places at the same time. Those both can't both be true. So those are two examples of internal inconsistency. Once we get the consistency sorted out, then it gets interesting because then we have to look at these other criteria. And the first one we've already spent quite a bit of time on, so I will jump over this quickly. This is coming from Popper, and even though we didn't ultimately accept his falsification account, we think that this testability stuff is really important. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't finish my example before I started this video. So we can think of, you know, what would testability mean? And for amusement, my daughter and I were wondering about, having carefully attended all these lectures, if Tiger could take the exam, you know. And we could say, you know, could Tiger take the exam? And we tried to test that by putting treats out on a grid with the possible answers, and Tiger just didn't participate. She was too smart for that. So, you know, testing the theory Tiger has learned philosophy seemed impossible because, you know, she wasn't able to participate in the test. That's so lack of testability in that case. And, you know, when we think about confirmation, you should always think, whenever I ask anything about confirmation, whether you ever hear a theory is confirmed, you let this slide jump into your mind, where you know that something in the positive case is a fallacious reasoning, and in the negative case is the interesting valid one, right? So then when we think about a theory being confirmed, and I want to sort of, you know, don't want to confuse things too much, but so the textbook we're currently working with doesn't even include repeated confirmation as a criteria, which seems maybe a little bit harsh. Mr. Copy makes the claim that if predictions based upon a hypothesis are true, this tends to show, notice how weaselly that is, tends to show, not very strong, tends to show that the hypothesis is true. And so, you know, and I've called these weasel words, these words like likely, tends, probably, suggest, indicates, all the sorts of words that very careful scientists are likely to use, but then end up sounding like they're being evasive and weaselly, right? So, if your theory is confirmed by a repeated experimentation, you've done the test and you get confirmed. You get the test and at some point you start to think, yeah, we're really onto something. McDonald and Vaughn don't even mention that as a criteria, but I think it should be considered relevant here that if you have a theory that's repeatedly confirmed, that might be something. And I think possibly the reason McDonald and Vaughn, your textbook authors, don't spend a lot of time on confirmation is because I think they've wrapped it up a little bit in this criteria called fruitfulness. Fancy word might be fecundity. A theory that generates more predictions and more observations. So a hypothesis or a theory is more probably true if it is fruitful, if it predicts and explains previously unknown things, right? So, and essentially that's what an experiment is meant to do, right? We say, well, if my theory is right, I'll get this observation. So you test it. And so fruitfulness and confirmation are kind of wrapped up together. So when we have a theory like COVID-19 is just like the flu, how fruitful is that? Does it help us treated in new and better ways. Quite the contrary. Once doctors stopped treating it like the flu and more as its own disease and treated the respiratory problems differently, the actual mortality rate started to go down. Treating it like the flu, not only were we wrong about mortality rates in that way, but also the medical indicators and treatments, once they were uniquely identified to this disease, actually helped treatment. So that was a theory that didn't have fruitfulness. It didn't help predict better outcomes and new information. The most famous story of theory fruitfulness is probably the reason Einstein is, you know, probably history's most famous and brilliant scientist. So he made this really bold prediction that gravity would bend light rays, and or just bend light, and that seemed at the time like a shockingly bold prediction, and could only be tested under very unique circumstances. Shortly after World War I, almost exactly 100 years ago, or 101 years ago now, I guess, there the perfect opportunity to test this arose. And basically calculations were that if you were on a very specific spot on a ship in the South Pacific, in the right place to observe a solar eclipse, that's when the sun is behind the moon, so that you can see stars that are close to the sun, but not the sun itself. This is the best diagram I could find, even though the labels are in German, but I think you can kind of figure it out, right? What we have is, if you're on that ship in the South Pacific and you're observing the solar eclipse, you can't see the sun, the moon is somewhere in between, but you can see a star right next to the sun, but we know, based on all of our evidence and theories about the way the stars appear in the sky, that star actually is behind the sun, and the light from that star would be blocked by the sun to our observational eyes there on the ship. The fact that we can see it is because the rays of light coming from that star are bent by the gravitational field of the sun. And so when England and Germany and the United States put a bunch of scientists on a ship right after World War I to go to the South Pacific to see if that happened, and I've taught this before, I never really thought that this is all in the middle of the 1919 flu, and I don't know if people on that ship got sick or died or anything, or whether they took measures against that. That would be a good history essay to write if you're in a course one day and you need a topic. But that's an aside for today. That very famous, very public, you can't put a bunch of people from a whole bunch of different countries on a ship and send it to the South Pacific and then, you know, not kind of keep it on the down low and only announce it if you get your result, right? Einstein, he wasn't personally involved, but his theory was really out there. It made this prediction, and it was either going to be very publicly correct or very publicly wrong. And when it turned out he was right, that was a big deal in the news. Probably people were looking for good news. People are dying of the flu. People are, you know, World War I is over and there's misery everywhere. We got some good news. That made a big deal. And that's one reason Einstein is as famous as he is. And remember, though, this is nothing about Einstein's theory was about, you know, this particular star and that particular place in the South Pacific. This is an expected observation if his theory is correct. That's exactly what fruitfulness is. If my theory is true, here's some new stuff that we expect to also be true. That's fruitfulness. Generating new predictions, new theories. Think about Darwin's theory of evolution, right? He was trying to explain specific species in specific places. Turns out his theory explains basically the nature of every species on Earth. What an incredibly fruitful theory that is. Next criteria we're going to talk about is scope. And we're thinking here of a broader explanatory scope. If this is explaining more phenomena than alternative hypotheses. And so if you got a theory, is it explaining other things? So you got a theory that your car won't start because your battery is dead. And you, oh yeah, that explains why the radio isn't working properly. And it's not charging my phone when I plug it in. And turns out the lights aren't very bright either, right? You start explaining a bunch of stuff. You go, this theory is really onto something. We should probably explain what we mean by scope. And, you know, the definition given before is, you know, kind of complicated because it uses this big university word phenomena, which philosophy uses that word kind of in a specialized way to mean any object, factor, occurrence perceived or observed. We think about phenomena being in the experience of the person, not necessarily out there in the world, right? And that's exactly what you're trying to explain. You're trying to explain, why did I see it? Or why do I believe it to be true? That's the phenomena you're trying to explain. And so we might want to just have a better definition being a theory has greater scope if it explains more diverse observations. Notice this diversity here too. We want to make sure we're not explaining the exact same thing over and over and over again. A theory that explains why birds of many different species have certain shaped beaks is much better than a theory that explains only why your particular parakeet is the way it is, right? And the fact that you'd observe your parakeet every day, those aren't new observations in the way that getting out into the world and seeing birds in different places from different species at different times of year, domestic and feral and large and small. You want lots of diverse observations. That's what we mean by scope. Opening up your observational opportunities. We did simplicity already, so I'll just remind you of our good friend Occam here. And that plurality should not be positive without necessity. Don't think of more things rather than less. Right? So all things being equal, the simplest explanation is the best. A physical theory, these are both quotes from Einstein, by the way, a physical theory should be as simple as possible, but no simpler, right? Which is good advice, but probably harder to do in practice than you'd think. But prefer a simple explanation when possible. And by simple, of course, we mean fewer causes, factors, or variables. Not necessarily easy to understand. Let's face it, Einstein's theory is not easy to understand, but he is not inventing more things in order to make his theory work. So, some examples of simplicity. Suppose you're trying to explain a student failing a statistics test. And one of our theories is the student didn't understand the material. Or a second theory that malicious textbook publishers put wrong answers in the study guide in hopes of sabotaging future statisticians, clearing the field for them to keep their jobs. Which of those theories is simpler, right? Well, you don't have to bring in all this, all these other people and their maliciousness of their intent and so on. And this very complicated long-term plan that they've got. None of that is necessary with the first explanation. Is the second explanation impossible? Certainly not. But we would prefer the first one just because it has fewer causal factors that needed to believe it. A theory that had some people excited early in the COVID era was this gentleman who proposed, he's an astrobiologist who had this idea that the virus was from a comet and a piece of space rock may have fallen to Earth during a fireball event over China in October 2019. And he has the theory that this has happened in the past, that viruses come from space through comets. If we're just looking at simplicity alone, boy, that seems like a little bit out there, doesn't it? You got to believe that these comets have viruses on them, that viruses could survive re-entry in the Earth's atmosphere when, you know, that's pretty hard. It gets kind of hot when you hit the Earth's atmosphere at hundreds of thousands of kilometers an hour or however fast you're traveling. And even if it hits the Earth's atmosphere going no fast, by the time it's fallen to Earth, it's going really fast, right? So that's tough. So I don't think that's a very simple theory. The last criteria is this conservatism. Now this one's needs a little bit more explanation. We tend to think of theories or hypotheses being more probably true if they're consistent with our other well-established beliefs. And so when you think your car won't start because your battery is dead, fits in with what you believe about electricity and the fact that batteries do go dead and cars needing a charged battery to start and so on. You've got all these antecedent assumptions about the way cars work. And whereas the theory that your car won't start because it's possessed by demons who are trying to thwart you doesn't fit as well with our theories about cars, right? And quite frankly, our theories about the existence of demons and so on. So the theory that fits better with your other beliefs tends to be preferred. But, and you're probably thinking, wait a minute. Haven't we sometimes had a history of not accepting new theories because they didn't fit and that not working out very well? Haven't we sometimes burnt people at the stakes for proposing new theories that turned out to be right, and yet, you know, we didn't appreciate that very much? Exactly. That is a huge problem here. I think this also kind of explains what we see around us when we watch people try to think through problems, right? So if people have other crazy beliefs, whether they believe, as you know, apparently around 50 million U.S. citizens believe that Donald Trump really won the election, or many people believe that COVID-19 is a hoax. Fewer, but not insignificant number of people believe the Earth is flat. I wish we were back in the days when Earth being flat was the wildest, craziest conspiracy theory that we could come up with in a class discussion a couple of years ago. Some people believe unicorns are real. If you have those beliefs, some other theories are going to be really hard to bring in, right? You've got a theory that COVID-19 is a hoax as an important part of the way you perceive the world. People talking to you about the effectiveness of vaccines is not going to fit with that. And so, now, is this good or bad? What this is going to tend to do is people who have better, more consistent, higher quality beliefs are more readily able to accept new, good, high quality beliefs. If you've got some sort of set of beliefs that are a little bit out there, you're probably going to actually drift off in that direction even more. And so now we could think of this as being in trouble, right? Because there are people who believe that the earth is flat. And so, and I got this slide from someone who was basically going to rework mathematics in order to justify his flat earth theory. Right. So I've got this really sincere, very ardent position that the earth is flat. I'm not so attached to mathematics, so I'll boot that out of my belief system and bring in some new math. I perceive that as a dangerous way to go, but that person is practicing conservatism in exactly the way that I think that person should, given his, the strong evidence that mathematics is pretty well worked out, that if you get contradictions in your physical calculations, you should probably throw out your flat earth and keep your math. So, what's the deal with this conservatism? I think this has a pretty good merit in that it does explain how we actually think. This is not a how we should think in a perfect world. This is how human science is really working here, right? We do accept new theories grudgingly. We reject existing beliefs extremely grudgingly, only when necessary, and usually only long after it was really obvious to everyone. So, generally speaking, if you're not already crazy, or don't already have kind of, let's say, outlier beliefs, you're going to not accept new theories that are also not outliers. But if you're already off in some other place, the beliefs you tend to accept will be those that match that. And so that's why, it is really difficult to, if someone has significantly different set of beliefs than yourself, just telling them they're wrong is probably not going to really work out very good. So, summary, we've got these criteria, and we think when a theory has a bunch of this really great stuff, then we think it's a good theory. Why? What would justify that line of thinking? And it's this. And there's Hume kind of, reminding us that this is induction stuff. We think these criteria, these virtues, make good, strong theories because in the past, theories that have had these criteria have tended to be the ones that have been borne out by further analysis and testing, right? The beliefs you have currently right now are the ones that have tended to have these criteria. And so if it works in the past, it'll work in the future. And there's Hume saying, wait a minute, that's induction, right? It's our past experience justifies our future acceptance of similar theories. Is it perfect? No. Is it the best we've got? Apparently so. So, a few quirks that we need to be aware of. You've got two theories, and you're being asked, which do I prefer? You could have, and the simple answer is, well, whichever one has the most of the criteria we've been discussing today. But you could have problems with that. One is you could just have a straight out tie. Well, I think both of them are equally good. What do you do? Do we think that some of those criteria are more important than others? Would I or would you prefer, say, simplicity to conservatism? You will happily accept a new theory if it's nice and simple. Other people would have the exact reverse preferences. And there's no obvious way to rank these criteria. Furthermore, even if you could rank them, we can't quantify them in any obvious way. Is there an agreed upon measurement for how simple something is? Not really. How conservative it is? Not really, right? So there's no obvious measurement here. And it's tempting to, or maybe dangerously likely to, sort of give up here. Hear me out. I think this inference to the best explanation is a good explanation of scientific method just because it has these possible problems. We know that quite regularly and for periods of time, well-informed, serious people have been engaged in disputes about which theory is best. We don't always know which theory we should prefer. If our account of scientific rationality didn't explain why you should sometimes get caught in these apparent ties between different theories, I think that would actually be a weakness of your explanation. We're trying to explain how science really works. And if our theory doesn't explain or doesn't predict that occasionally scientists aren't going to have what they need to make a clear single preference, then our theory would probably be inadequate. So what should happen when two theories or perhaps even more theories appear to be equally meritorious for these criteria? Well, actually at that point, you should start designing more experiments to find that case where a theory makes a prediction that the other theory does not, and then you run the experiment to see if you get the observation or not. And then you get back to that sort of the one overwhelming criteria of consistency, right? Once you've got an observation that only one theory predicts, you're done, right? The other theory is either needs to go back to the drawing board and revise itself or give up. When you have inference to the best explanation, you're choosing the best theory from the theories you have. It's not unexpected that you'll wake up tomorrow morning and there'll be a new, better theory for what it is you're trying to explain, right? So every theory that we have could be superseded by an even better theory. And so that explains why all of our language about induction is guarded and cautious and tentative, right? We're going to say maybe, probably, likely, instead of proof and certainty. We're avoiding those claims. This is never going to be valid. This is going to be, if we've done everything right, we've got good observations and strong explanatory power, nice fruitful theory, consistent with our other beliefs and so on. This seems like a pretty good theory. None of that is proof. So how do we put all this to use? How do we apply this? So imagine that we went down to the carnival and back when there were such things, and we saw an astrologer and she dealt out the tarot cards or whatever her method was, and she predicted that you would hate critical thinking. And at this point in the course, you're realizing, oh, there's an exam in a week. I hate this class. Seems like your astrologer was right. Seems like that confirms the theory she's using to make these predictions. Doesn't that mean astrology is a good theory? Well, what do we think about that? What's our criteria? Is it internally consistent? it's not contradictory in any obvious way. Is it simple? Is it, well, now we're proposing there's a causal relationship between the cards or the planets or whatever else and your life. That's new stuff that we didn't think existed before. So not all that simple. Does this fit in well with our other theories about how the world works? Not so much, right? So like, I can see why this is not the best explanation. Better explanation for your astrologer's prediction is she's taking critical thinking and she knows it's not going to be easy. And, you know, 18 to 25 year olds prefer to take a path of least resistance. And so she's making a shrewd guess based on easily available information we all have. That's a much better explanation of her prediction than believing that she's got magical powers the rest of us do not. When you're trying to explain a crime, the way Sherlock does in those famous books, Sherlock says, Moriarty being the murderer would explain his fingerprints on the weapon, the victim's blood on his jacket, the assumption that any of the... Okay, so we've got two things we're explaining. The assumption that any of the other suspects has committed the murder leaves us without an explanation of these traces. Moriarty must be the murderer, right? So the scope of explanation here is greater than the other competing theories. This is a fruitful, nice scoped out theory. We like this one better. Generally speaking, if you are either defending or prosecuting a legal case, you do not want to leave issues unexplained. Juries don't like loose threads. Makes for a good podcast, though. Let's talk about Nikki. So Nikki made a bunch of predictions. These are predictions for 2019. And I think some of these were for... Yeah, these are 2019 predictions. Bushfires, wildfires in Australia. I mean, it's hard to think back that far now, but yeah. Protests and riots worldwide. Yeah, we got that. Earthquakes in Alaska and British Columbia. Think so. Widespread flooding in Romania. Typhoon hitting Australia. Many shipwrecks found. A monster storm in Shanghai and Hong Kong. Protests in Rome, Italy. Jimmy Carter hospitalized. Now, we have two theories for how Nikki can make these predictions. One is she's tuned into the world of the stars, and not the world of Hollywood stars, although I think, you know, there's a cool equivocation in her name. Nikki, astrologer to the stars, right? That's kind of fun, right? She claims to be an advisor to celebrities in Hollywood. That's what she means by stars. But also, you know, astrology relies on stars. That's kind of fun. But what is she doing when she makes these correct predictions? Well, Jimmy Carter's an elderly man in his 90s. Getting into the hospital, not too much of a risk. Storms in the Sea of Japan and China, not that unusual. Shipwrecks, you bet. That's a routine matter. Typhoon hitting Australia. I probably think there's not too many years where that doesn't happen. Protests and riots worldwide. Well, I mean, she predicted that in 2019. She really missed the boat if she didn't predict that in 2020. So, and we saw earlier that Nikki's making about 1,000 predictions. And some of them are going to turn out to be right. She's making shrewd guesses here. Nikki, and she, you know, New Year's is kind of astrologer's time of year. You know, if you're any kind of astrologer, you're going to get booked on some TV show on New Year's Day, just like every fiddle band gets a gig on St. Patrick's Day and so on, right? So a couple of her recent appearances on CBS New York on Christmas, New Year's Eve of last year, where she predicted where and her introduction. So this is a direct quote of her introduction. Many of her predictions from last year, worldwide protests, roller coaster stock market, extreme weather events, UFO sightings, we should heed, the implication is, we should heed Nikki's advice for 2020 because she was right last year. That's an example of confirmation. And then her introduction on breakfast television in Toronto, I think that's Global Television Show. After her exciting on-par predictions in 2019, Psychic Nikki is back to give us a first look at what to expect for the upcoming year. Okay, so we're being told confirmation means reliability. What do we think that means? And I think what we've learned in the course is it doesn't mean that much. Right? We think here's Nikki making more predictions for 2020, danger on Prime Minister Trudeau and health issues. Well, good guess on that one. A Wall Street panics as there are worldwide fluctuations in the stock market. Yep, that happened. Stock markets are very volatile around the world. You bet, okay? So her predictions for 2020, not all of them are wrong. What do we think about that confirmation? Well, first of all, just on sort of inductive fallacies, we say there's a huge bias here. We are noticing only the confirmation cases, not the disconfirmation cases, right? We could learn about this as the Texas sharpshooter fallacy. We're picking out of the 1,000 predictions, the few that she gets right. When she shanks one, when she misses a pandemic that affects the whole world, we ignore that. But when she predicts that Justin Trudeau might have a health issue, we think that's a big thing. So we're worried about that. We're also worried about the conservatism of this. We need to believe, to take Nikki seriously, that somehow she's getting information by some other weird world that the rest of us can't. And that's probably, whether that be, doesn't fit with her other theories. She's predicting causal mechanisms the rest of us don't accept. So there's a lack of simplicity there. This theory of astrology or psychic power does not fit well with the criteria of adequacy we're working with. And so that's why we would not prefer Nikki to Fauci. Early in the pandemic, this cool looking picture was circulated with this theory that coronavirus, before it reaches the lungs, remains in the throat for 4 days. And this time, if the person drinks water a lot and gargling with warm water and salt or vinegar eliminates the virus. What do we think about that theory? Well, it's testable. You could set up an experiment to have half of a number of people gargle with salt and vinegar and half not, and see if you would get a difference in people contracting COVID cases. So it is testable. Is it fruitful? Does it predict new observations? Not particularly. Does it have good scope? Does it include diverse observations? Well, it could if it worked around the world. Doesn't seem to make predictions about other viruses or anything else. So that's kind of maybe a 50-50. Is it simple? I don't think it's proposing anything new here. Does it fit well with our other theories? You might go to a person who's an expert in infectious disease and say, is this how viruses work? Is this what's going on with viruses in general? And they would go, no. We would probably rule this one out on, either by doing a test or by realizing this just doesn't fit with our theories about disease. Now, the problem, of course, is not too many people know necessarily how viruses work. And it's got this really cool scientific-looking photo that makes it seem like it's speaking from an area of expertise. But of course, if this were the case, we would have put an end to this whole COVID thing, you know, months ago, right? So I assume a few people tried this. It was a viral sensation in itself on the internet in I believe, early April of 2020. So, you should prefer theories, first of all, that are internally consistent. And then that are testable, or it's nice and simple, ontologically or thing-wise, right? And causes, factors, variables, not simple as in easily understood. Fruitfulness, making new predictions, should, and in a way, you know, some of these are interrelated, right? A theory needs to be fruitful, needs to make at least one prediction in order to be testable, right? Theory needs good scope. It needs to fit with our other best theories. And if that's what you have, then that's your best theory. And that's what you should accept. And that's where we end. Just a couple housekeeping matters. Please update your SRI, which is the student response, the course evaluation process in these times on UM Learn. And while you're doing that, you can think about the implicit bias. Remember, I've talked lots of times about how you can get bias completely innocently and unintentionally. Here's a great case of that. At the end of term, there you are filling out your course evaluation, and by trying to encourage you to do it, I'm trying to get as diverse a sample as possible. I don't just email the A-plus students and ask them to complete it. Or in the old days, a pretty good useful trick was to try to figure out what day of the week or maybe time of year the fewest and only most motivated students would show up to class and do your course evaluation then. You know, I'm telling every person watching this video, please fill out your course evaluation. Who's not seeing this video? The people who dropped out of the class weeks ago. If I was doing something horribly wrong, all the people who figured that out have bailed out. So I'll never know about it. So even when you try to have good statistics, you can still screw it up. So please, you know, feel free to speak on behalf of, if you had a friend who dropped the course and you know why, let me know. I encourage you to prepare study notes for the exam. It's open book, anything goes. I'm not even going to say honor system because I'm not expecting you to comply with anything. At the same time, I'll be designing an exam that's going to attempt to measure your skill in the concepts and tools we've learned in the course. So go ahead and look it up, but you'll still have to do it. And that's my thinking about the design of the exam. Make sure you note your exam time on UM Learn or on the Registrar's Office website. On behalf of myself and Tiger the Cat, who is laying in a sunbeam just off camera here, I thank you for your attention. I hope Tiger wasn't too much of a distraction and maybe even the best part of the whole course. I've heard from many of you. I accept that as a necessary consequence of how we're doing things. I wish you all well. Had we had a quiz or an exam in person, I would have shaken the hand of each one of you and wished you well. I'll have to do that in this very impersonal way. I hope we meet one day. I have no idea what you look like, so I leave it to you if you choose when you see me in some future capacity to say hello, and I would very much enjoy meeting you then. Please be well. Take care.